So I'm Jeff Mittelstadt with the Center for Sustainable Enterprise at Kenan Flagler Business School at University of North Carolina in the US. And I'm going to hand it over to Arvind Chari, who's from Quantum Advisors, and he's going to introduce our guests today for the Q&A session. So Arvind, I'm handing it over to you.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you so much. We are talking today to Jyoti Pandey, just as we had a session yesterday where she will make a few initial comments on the things that she's seen in whatever is happening in India, especially in the air pollution space. What kind of new technologies are coming through? Are there new things that she's seeing? Is the government responsive? Students who haven't seen her video yet, please go on the India Impact website and look up her video, and also look up a book. So she wrote a very, and that's how we got in touch with her. So her book is titled "Breathing in India is Injurious to Your Health." You know, and I immediately ordered it. And then I interviewed her. It's a brilliant take and gets our attention to something which we face on a daily basis. It's invisible, sometimes visible, but it's in your face, and the impact that it is having to children, to senior citizens, to general people. Not many of us are aware of what could be the problems of air pollution. And the book is about her experience in Delhi, but it's largely true in almost every city in India. Air pollution is a very, very big problem. And Jyoti is special in that sense that she left the blue skies of San Francisco, was it, Jyoti?
Yeah, Palo Alto, California.
Palo Alto, California, and moved her family and herself back to Delhi, to the gray and dull and polluted skies of Delhi. And so she also has a NGO called Care for Air, which kind of raises issues, interacts with the government, and gets air pollution center stage in terms of how people should be thinking about it. So we had a wonderful discussion, and thanks for that time, and thanks for coming back again and directly speaking to students. As I said, this is a recorded session, and students who are not here live will be able to see this. So in our first discussion, we spoke about general, right? What is air pollution? How is it related to the climate? And what are we seeing in India, and how is the government responding? What are the things that you are seeing as issues and opportunities? Today, if you can talk specifically about, now that you've been interacting with the government, you're interacting with people who are either affected by air pollution or are trying to figure out solutions to solve this air pollution problem. You're speaking to students, you're speaking to corporates, you're speaking to NGOs, government, public policy people. If you can highlight two or three or as many as you want in terms of trends or new opportunities or new solutions, new technologies that you are seeing, which can have a significant impact and which can also become a segue for the students to think if somebody is looking at air pollution as an aspect of climate change, they can have some takeaways in terms of how they want to build their business case study in terms of what is actually happening in India. So over to you. 15, 20 minutes, and then we will have a Q&A.
Okay, so I'm going to just quickly back up a little bit and first speak about how the level of awareness, especially in a country like India, where 99.5% of the country lives in areas where air pollution is well above the WHO standards. How few people are truly aware of how bad it is, and more than that, the actual the impact, the health impact, and how it is affecting their health on a daily basis. But we all know that air pollution and climate change are linked. However, air pollution is something that people generally feel they could be a little more in control of, because climate change, you kind of glaze over and you think of glaciers melting in at the poles and all of that. even with air pollution, when we talk to people, I find that there is a general sense of helplessness and powerlessness around it. And that's where I think we should start with any kind of solution, because even before solutions come in, I think awareness needs to be sort of grown. When you have awareness and the outrage that comes with that, when you realize how much air pollution is affecting our health today, right now, yesterday. And again, that's the reason why I wrote this book, Breathing Here is Injurious to Your Health, was it's a personalized narrative of my mother's struggle with when she was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer with absolutely no symptoms at all. You know, just as she would keep saying, a little bit of breathlessness, which is what made me realize, because by then, by the time she was diagnosed in 2017, I had already been working in air pollution for about 4 years. I knew everything, or rather, I thought I knew everything about it. But again, it's very different to know it in your head and to see somebody struggling with it and know it in your heart. So the reason I wrote this book as a personalized narrative and not really a purely scientific, sort of journalistic scientific book, is because I find that people respond to personal stories, and I wanted to pull in people to really understanding that this is not an abstract problem somewhere else. It's a real problem in our own backyards, every day, everywhere. And that's how some of the chapters are named, actually, everywhere. Every day. In fact, I think one of the chapters I called Every Breath You Take, based on the Sting song. So, you know, I think, and I've just last week written a journalistic piece, which was published in a local digital news magazine, where I've really said that conversations on air pollution need to stop being from expert to experts. It really needs to, we need to pull this out of the research silos. And I think in India, they are out of the research silos now, but they're still in echo chambers. We need to take them out of the echo chambers into the real world, where people who are affected by air pollution actually know what it is doing to their health. So with that as background, I think that's the canvas we need to first set up to understand that to bring in solutions, we need, it's very closely linked with awareness. So even when it comes to solutions, there would be solutions which would be awareness building solutions, and those are also solutions, and innovations and solutions which are sort of true solutions which are reducing emissions at source. Okay, so I'm going to just start by saying that innovations could include measuring and monitoring emissions, or measuring and monitoring exposure, which are two different things, or they could be innovations that are helping reduce emissions or reduce exposure. And let me be clear when I say that, because this is really a pet peeve of mine, outdoor smog towers and outdoor air filters are not a solution by any stretch of scientific imagination. And in fact, sadly, the Indian Supreme Court has recently, I think about 6 months ago, asked for outdoor air purifiers in different parts of Delhi and other parts of the country. And other cities are also beginning to catch on to this sort of, how shall I say, fake solution. This actually makes people feel that the government is doing something, or whoever setting up this smog tower is doing something to help us. It's a red herring. It's something that, in fact, I have argued in different articles, and there is also a scientific article, and I'm happy to share the links of that, because we use those scientific articles to plead in the Supreme Court of the country to actually we've asked them for a stay on these smog towers, as they are called, anti-smog towers. And unfortunately, our petition was dismissed. So now currently public money is being used for these completely non-solution solutions. So I'm bringing this up because I want to make it very clear what a solution is not, and then we move on to what different solutions can be. The last thing I want to say on these smog towers is On the contrary, smog towers that of the sort we have seen in China and also in India, which have physical filters, actually add to pollution. Because what are you going to do with these clogged filters once they have caught the PM2.5 particles? In a country like India, where most landfills are absolutely overflowing, we have a couple of landfills in Delhi that are actually taller than the Taj Mahal and the Qutub Minar, which is something I'm not proud to say. And oftentimes, these landfills will catch fire. Sometimes those fires are deliberate. And other times, those fires just form because of methane combustion and things like that. So what happens is, and this is also for those of us, and sadly, that includes me, who use air purifiers in our homes to clean our indoor air, because ultimately, the physical filters of these as well need to be disposed of, and the concept of responsible disposal of these filters currently does not exist in India. So they go out with your trash and again back in the landfills. So my personal space is cleaned up at the cost of collective space outdoors, and especially your waste pickers and people who are not from a very privileged socioeconomic strata who live around these landfills, and therefore they are actually suffering. The more we clean our personal indoor air and toss out these filters, the more these people suffer who live around landfills which are burning because of increasing trash from physical filters. So having said that, and having, I think made pretty clear that I do not believe in outdoor smog towers being any sort of solution, I can say if we use something like an outdoor smog tower, for example, indoors, if we moved an outdoor smog tower to a underground metro station, for example, and we tried to make it filterless. I know of smog towers which companies have made which run without filters. Now that could technically qualify as a solution. If you put them in public spaces, like Indian hospitals are overflowing. When you have an outpatient department which has thousands of people and the kind of footfalls that that exist out there, and you put an outdoor or a large air purifier in that indoor space, then at least if you're using public money, you can justify it to a small extent by saying, yes, at least it's cleaning up some amount of air and you're getting some bang for your buck. Now, other innovations which include, I'm first focusing on awareness innovations. So if you had, for example, a bus, if every bus stop had low cost sensors, so again, the public is standing there waiting for buses, they're reading these low cost sensors which are being, which are on every bus stop. And for India has a very large population that isn't literate. So converting that into emoticons, having actual a sad face of a crying child when the AQI goes very high, or a happy smiling face of a child. So kind of communicating not through words. I'm sorry, you're going to have to excuse me. This is really the pollution because I have been outside quite a bit today. Having these kind of things would be a great start for in terms of increasing public awareness. I had heard a podcast of, this was about 3 years ago, where this woman on the podcast was actually talking about streetlights, which change color based on the AQI of that area. And I think something like that would be phenomenal, because that immediately makes you aware as you're crossing a street, you go through a very polluted part of town, and you see the streetlight changing color. That would be a very cool way, I think, of communicating something without speaking, without words, but just, people would ask, like, why did that just go yellow or orange? And I think making people aware is in itself the beginning of a solution. Again, other things that I thought about is, and I think some of these are happening, I'm not sure to what extent and how much, but, you know, wearable devices like, you know, these IoTs, like an Apple Watch kind of thing, which could tell you, for example, what your exposure through the day had been. For example, I mean, when we walk, we have a device which will tell us how many steps we walk. We know how to measure calories, you know, what goes in, what comes out. I think it's equally important to know what our exposure to air quality is, and if there could be an algorithm that converts it into our ability. You know, for example, if I've been exposed to a high episodic spike in air pollution just because I passed through a very highly polluting area, if there was also a health link to that, that now my exposure, because I've been exposed to such a high level of air pollution, my chances of having a heart attack or stroke or whatever, you know, go up by this X amount, you know, something like that would also, again, be great for bringing awareness and linking it to health impact. Again, things like reducing emissions at source. I was mentioning to Arvind, there is a company based out of Pune that I have interacted with. In fact, they won the Polish Smogathon a couple of years ago. They have built this little device which you attach to the tailpipe of cars or diesel gensets, of which there are several in India even now, where it catches the emission at source. So at the chimney, at the exhaust or the exhaust of these vehicles or diesel generators, where it kind of catches the PM2.5 particles, converts it into carbon black, and then is able to complete that circle by using it like black ink, or I think there's somebody who's also using it to make boot polish. Again, I'm not sure. I know for a fact that this company based out of Pune, is run by a few engineers. They have been struggling with getting funding for something like this. And I think they've survived the last 3 or 4 years, but it's not as if people are going like, yes, we've got to do this, because I personally think if there is a device like this that exists, and these guys have gotten their, they've gotten tested from the, pollution control boards. They've also, now the problem in India also is that you don't have a lot of certification right here that will allow and support entrepreneurship to that extent. But if you had something that was supportive of innovations like this, then I would expect something like this to really move fast. By now, this company should have been selling these devices to, and they should be available for retrofitting. In fact, I would go one step forward and say that the government should actually mandate that all old cars, which are not BS6, which is Euro 6 compliant, which don't have US Euro 6 compliant engines. And currently in India, thankfully now you can get Euro 6 BS6 fuel. So engine plus fuel, which is compliant to BS6 norms. If your car does not fit that, then it should be mandated that they should get things like this retrofitted. The kind of vehicular emission that I've seen on the highways from these diesel trucks and other trucks, I mean, it's if you see it, you will recoil in just looking at how much thick a black soot seems to come out of the tailpipe of these cars. Of course, there are other, so this is something that I know exists, and I know it's more than one company that is doing something like this. I believe there's another company which is being incubated out of IIT Delhi, which I believe the name is Chakra, which is also doing something similar, that is building an innovative device that catches emissions at source. Now that's a real solution. The minute you're talking about catching emission at source, you're talking real solutions. Also, now we have a lot of focus on electric vehicles. The Delhi government actually has done something which I think is very progressive. They have not only pledged to convert the fleet of government cars to electric vehicles, they are looking to buy electric buses, so public transport, which should be electric. There is so much of room for entrepreneurial and innovative problem-solving techniques in areas of renewable energy and batteries for electric vehicles. We still want to ensure that these vehicle batteries formally complete that circular economy circle. We don't want to be, I think we have made some progress from the lead batteries to now the lithium ion, but capturing that energy, innovations in capturing renewable energy and storing it in the most effective way would be another great area that would indirectly help air pollution. So again, to go back to how I started, measuring and monitoring and finding ways to do that, innovative ways which become part of the system. So today when I look at the weather, if I'm deciding to go for a run or an outdoor picnic, I will look to see what the weather is going to be like. There should be, I think, something that tells me, or maybe it could be a device, it could be just getting onto an app. When I find out what the weather is, it should automatically also tell me what pollution levels are going to be, especially in the northern part of India, where, you know, pollution is practically high through the year, although it's supposed to be a seasonal problem. And it is seasonal to the extent that it goes beyond, you know, four figures. Sometimes in November and December, we have measured with extremely high quality monitors that pollution levels go up to 1300. Now remember, 10 is the limit that the WHO sets, and we have gone beyond 1300. So that's like, you know, I don't even know what to call that. It's off the charts. So to be able to be constantly aware of that, so measuring and monitoring of air pollution, and then measuring and monitoring of exposure, our exposure to air pollution, would be the areas that I would say are best suited to any sort of, how shall I say, real solutions. And the last thing I want to say is that I think, you know, I've read recently, this has been around for the longest time, this Swiss or Swedish university, which had come up with how they create diamonds out of the particulate matter, because again, it's carbon, it's, so I think these are good in terms of building awareness, but I think actual solutions, once you have the entire circle, including the responsible disposal of whatever it is that you're creating, in this case, in the case of electric vehicles, your batteries, how do you dispose it in the end? Where are you getting it from? How valuable is it to, so currently we're using electric vehicles which are running on electricity, which is not powered by renewable energy. That's still better than not doing it, because currently what we're doing it is moving it out of tailpipes into chimneys, right? But there is the next step, which is bringing in renewable energy and then completing that entire circle. And that's what I want to say. I want to say that any innovative solution which does not complete the entire circle, to me, is an incomplete solution. So when you have something that starts from how I'm going to solve this problem to how I'm going to dispose of whatever, because what we don't want is we've solved this problem and now we have a new problem to solve. So I think I'll stop there. And if there are any questions or if there's anything else that we all want to discuss, and I've kept this very free flowing and not really sort of, I wanted, because I know there's students here and I don't think PowerPoint presentations are very welcome in such situations.
Discussions are always interactive. Discussions are always better. Absolutely. But before we go on to the questions, I have a comment and a follow-up question for you. In terms of awareness, I think the younger generation is so much aware. Like my daughter is 11. And she uses the weather app. So we have families across in US and Canada and Australia. And she's put all those things. And she'll keep scrolling. And she should do it when she was even nine and a half, you know, about a year and a half back. And she'll see blue skies in Toronto and blue skies in San Francisco. And skies in Delhi and gaze at the bomb. And she'll be alarmed or they're saying that, why is it always like this? Why is it always, and in Bombay and Delhi, you'll say haze, you know, that's the term that comes about. And then in the Western cities, it'll be clear skies. And then now they also have AQI. So now she started to learn to read AQI also. And she said, today, India, Bombay's AQI is 300. Do not go out, you know.
Right.
So I think the awareness is building pretty sharp, very, very, very fast. And I think that's a very good sign. Also,
right.
I don't know, many must have seen it also. New York Times, I think it was in the NY Times, did a very super piece of comparing two kids in Delhi. One lives in the slum and one lives in a urban high-end residential apartment. And they tracked their exposure, as you point out, through the day. And through charts and visuals, they put out a brilliant piece on what kind of exposure of air pollution does a person living in the slum face and a person who is at times outside, but at most times in the home, air-conditioned house, purifiers. When they go in the car, it's air-conditioned, windows rolled up, not so much exposure. And it's a brilliant piece. I think, you know, such kind of awareness is very, very good to see. If you have any comment on that, Jyoti, you can answer. My
Absolutely. I agree with you. And I think that was the best piece of journalism. As an air pollution activist, I can tell you that's the best piece of journalism that I saw in the last, five years. Actually, the New York Times has been, and it's there in my book, that entire journey, where Gardner Harris, who was one of the correspondents for the New York Times back in 2014-15, the problem has always been, in terms of awareness, that the information is all out there. It's there on the internet, it's there on government websites. And this was what actually had also pushed me, because when I came back from Palo Alto and I couldn't understand why my children and their friends kept getting sick every single winter, and it was, you know, definitely not just the viruses that was making them sick. And then my expat friends told me, are you crazy? Why did you come back? You know, you've put your kids at high risk now. And my Indian friends, so I was born and raised in India, and my friends who had grown up with went like, you've just become a foreigner in your own country. You know, you get that kind of the ugly Indian thing, and you know, rightly so, because it does happen. You forget the heat and the dust and the mosquitoes and the flies and all of that. And I was very clear that, you know, I was not going to just, so first I couldn't figure out, am I overreacting or am I underreacting? And then as a trained as a journalist. So the only thing I had that I could do was research this. And it was horrifying to find that all this information was available. It was just opaque. It was very well hidden in the public domain. And that still exists. In fact, I'm writing a piece currently, which is talking about exactly this, how information that industries have about their own pollution, their own effluents, and their own emissions is again very well hidden in within their own excellent monitors, which they're supposed to share with the Central Pollution Control Board. And again, the reason why I loved the New York Times piece that you're mentioning is it showed, it did not tell. And that's the premise of any good storytelling. You show, you don't tell. You don't talk about this is how it is, you show it. And they did that excellently through their visuals and through their journalism, where they followed these two children. They got personal emission monitors. And that's actually why I brought up that other innovation that I was talking about, the IoT device that, you know, today, if I had a watch that I was wearing all the time, or a locket or something that was constantly measuring how much exposure, how much air pollution I'm being exposed to through the day, because different people live in different parts of the city, and pollution in different parts of even hyperlocal pollution is very different from one part of the city to another, leave alone, you know, north, south and east and west of India and the coastal towns and the hills and all of that. So to have a personal emission monitor, which is what the New York Times did for their story, where they had a PEM for the rich kid and the poor kid, to just put it, boldly. They found that they actually were able to show how air pollution is a social inequity. And it is, and I've been writing about that for so long, because you see, in my country, and I believe in other countries as well, because I was reading something that one of our student volunteers found from a student in Vietnam, where the first thing that governments will tell you is that, oh, in our country, we have so much poverty, we need jobs and employment, and you know, we need poverty alleviation rather than air pollution work. And I'm saying no, even before all of that, because when you have a person who's poor, and now he's sick because he's constantly breathing bad air, and you do not have, he does not have the option of not going into work because he's a daily wage labor, and he can hardly say, oh, today pollution's high, so you know what, I'm not going to go and work and earn and eat. So I think that it's a worse it's a worse inequity than anything else. And I to see this, to see the New York Times show this rather than what we've been doing, which is telling and writing about it, I think it was brilliant. And I'm so glad that you brought more attention to that, because we need more stories like that. We need more, you know, like I've been saying, we need to use our art, our music, our literature, our games, you know, gamifying all of this. We need to use all of that to bring more and more attention to the health harm of air pollution and how it is a social inequity, in order to give it, it works two ways. We want to pressure the government to come up with policies that will help clean the air. And we also want to give the government the confidence that when they come up with policies that will help clean the air, the public will support them. So it's a two-way street. And I think what you've said is really important, because stories like this will help build the narrative that air pollution is a social inequity, and it's affecting all of us, and nobody with lungs and who's alive can escape this. So yeah.